ओम स्थापकाय च धर्मस्य सर्वधर्मस्वरूपिणे अवतार वरिष्ठाय रामकृष्णाय ते नमः। टुडे ये डे 157th बर्थ एनिवर्सरी ऑफ स्वामी अखंडानंद जी, वन ऑफ द 16 मोनेस्टिक डिसाइपल्स ऑफ श्री रामकृष्ण। वी ऑल नो दैट स्वामी श्री रामकृष्ण हैड गिवन मोनेस्टिक वोज टू 16 यंग डिसाइपल्स ऑफ हिम एंड वन ऑफ देम वॉज स्वामी अखंडानंद। अखंडानंद इज इन द प्री मोनेस्टिक ईयर्स यूज टू बी कॉल्ड गंगाधर बंदोपाध्याय। His father was Srimanta Bandopadhyay and mother was Vama Sundari. He was born on a Friday, which was a Mahalaya day. That means the first day of the Navaratri. He had three elder sisters. It is said that he was born with any labor pain to mother. From the childhood itself, the child was very attractive and very precocious. So once some relative, when the child was hardly a year old, so some relative put a thin gold chain around his neck. Small child, you see, a few months old or maybe 1 year old. So the thin gold chain, the child would not allow that to be on his body. It went on pulling at it until the chain broke and fell down. Then it felt quite happy. So that shows in future he would be in such a profession where he would not allow any gold to come near him. Gold means the desires of name, fame, etc. And from the very young age, his power of concentration was tremendous. As small boys, he would move about with other boys. And naturally, other boys, when they would see some fruit on a tree, they would pelt stones to make them fall down. But Gangadhar had his own way. He said, "No, no, I will not throw stones just like that blindly. I will tell you which fruit I want to throw, bring it down. I throw it only at that fruit." And he would throw with such concentration, it would hit that particular fruit and it would fall down. From the very young age, he had this tremendous power of concentration and also forbearance. Forbearance is, at 8 years, he had a small wound between the eyebrows that had become rather troublesome. So they wanted to operate this wound and they wanted to give him some chloroform. At that time, there was no local anesthesia. For everything they would give full anesthesia. He said, "No, I don't want any full anesthesia. I'll keep quiet, you operate." A 8-year-old boy kept quiet until the operation was over and it was successful. So the boy became 12 years old and he heard that one Paramahamsa had come to a nearest house, and that was the house of one Kalinath Basu. So this young fellow went, 12 years old, and just saw the Paramahamsa. When he saw, Sri Ramakrishna was in ecstatic state. He was in samadhi and he was singing a song about Mother Kali. Asita je bansiloye akbar nacho go shyama. Oh mother, you are Shyama, so you give up the sword. Take up a flute like Shyam. You are Shyama, you become Shyam and throw away the sword and take a flute in your hand. So Sri Ramakrishna was singing and was in ecstasy and samadhi. So this impression was there, this boy of 12 years. One day he found one sannyasi, wandering monk, come to his house. So this boy was very keen to inquire what are all the pilgrimages he has made. So when he heard this sannyasi he belonged to the Udasi Sampradaya. So he, when this sannyasi told him all the different pilgrimages he had made, he was so much tempted, "I will also come with you and see all the pilgrimages which you are going to make." Now, he simply walked off with this Udasi sannyasi without taking the permission or informing anybody at home. So after he had gone away, then the people at home came to know that he had gone away with the sannyasi. So they were completely confused what to do. And then mother was the most feelingful lady. So she says, "I must go and find out my child." She went on pilgrimage after pilgrimage in search of her son. But nowhere he could be found. She went to the farthest, up Haridwar. Up to Haridwar, all the pilgrimages she just went, but couldn't find him. Then what should he do? She returned home via Kashi. In Kashi, she met Trailinga Swami. So Trailinga Swami reassured her, "Don't worry, your son will come back." When she came back, he found this boy, Gangadhar, is back at home. He must have seen some pilgrimages, and after satisfying himself, he came back. Mother was angry naturally. Then she said, "Why did you take birth in this house? If you want to be indisciplined like this and hurt your parents like this?" He said, "Why, I have done a good thing to you." She said, "Good thing? What good thing have you done?" The young boy says, "But for me, could you have seen so much of pilgrimages? See, you went to all the pilgrimages and had the privilege of seeing that." Would the mother laugh or cry? You yourself can imagine. So the boy became, at 19 years or 20 years old, he met Sri Ramakrishna again at Dakshineshwar. He must have heard about him, and at that time he was also feeling the necessity of a guru. So he went and met Sri Ramakrishna at Dakshineshwar. Then Sri Ramakrishna naturally asked, "Have you met me earlier?" He was just 19, 20, but looking much younger. Even in this photograph you see, so he is 70 years old, but he looks very much, very young. So he had very robust health and was short in stature. He looked very young. So Sri Ramakrishna asked, "Have you seen me earlier?" "Yes, as a boy." He, at that time, 19, 20, he was looking like a boy only, 14 years old. He says, "As a boy, I have seen you." That was at 12 years old at Kali Basu's house. Then Sri Ramakrishna was surprised. He shouted at Ramla, "Hey Ramla, see this little fellow telling he had a boyhood earlier than this. Already he just only is a boy. He says, at an earlier age, as a boy he has seen me." Then he told, "Come on some Saturday. On that day is a very auspicious day. You come to me." So next meeting, Sri Ramakrishna wrote some mantra upon his tongue. That was the way he initiated him. Then made him sit comfortably, and this young boy went into deep samadhi, deep ecstasy, at the showing that he was an adept in meditation. On another day, Sri Ramakrishna was there lying down on his bed. He was massaging. So when he found that his body, his bones were so soft as if made of butter because of the very severe austerities he performed, his whole body had become so delicate. His bones were also had become very soft. On another day, Sri Ramakrishna advised him, this young man of 19 years, he was following all sort of rules and regulations. He would not eat from the food cooked by anybody. He himself used to cook just ordinary food with some vegetable, and that only he would take. And then he would go and take bath in Ganga or in some other water resource twice or thrice in a day. And so Sri Ramakrishna advised him, "What is all these oldish rules you are following? You are a young man. See Narendra, he eats anything. Not like you, cooking a few, one or two items and eating and not touching the food cooked by others. He eats everything, but sees Narayana in everyone. In Calcutta, Calcutta people are supposed to be very worldly people. In them, he sees Narayana. See the tremendous spiritual development he has. So you should be like that. Try for spiritual evolution, not this all external observances of bathing four times or not eating from somebody else's cooked food, etc. Then Gangadhar, in a way, modified all other habits. He went and met Swamiji also. He was very much impressed. And we see that Swamiji developed a special love for Gangadhar. So the Gangadhar one day went for meditation and returned, and Sri Ramakrishna questioned him, "Did you shed tears during your meditation?" Then Gangadhar answered, "Yes." Then Sri Ramakrishna demonstrated to him, "Yes, you must weep like a child would cry for its mother." And Sri Ramakrishna himself sat down like a small child, spreading both its feet and both his hands like this, and then cried with loud voice, "Oh mother, oh mother, oh mother." Like this you must cry for mother. Then she will certainly give you vision. So the young man was astonished at the poignant demonstration. Then August 16th, 1886, a very important date, when Sri Ramakrishna left his mortal body in Mahasamadhi, then all these youngsters were left to stay in a haunted house at Baranagar. It was in 1887 that Gangadhar wanted to start on a long pilgrimage. At that time he had not taken the Gerua robe, the ochre robe, whereas others had donned the ochre robe. He did not don the ochre robe. As a white shirted brahmachari, he started off on the pilgrimage to Himalayas. First he came to Rishikesh. Rishikesh, the starting point for all Kedar, Badri, and Gangotri, Yamunotri, Gomukh, and everything. Kedar, Rishikesh is the starting point. So he came to Rishikesh. There he found one avadhut, a famous avadhut, Mayaram avadhut. He was talking to his disciples and devotees. This young man went to him and asked, "Sir, which is the path to go to Kedar?" Then he was surprised at this young boy of 19 years asking the path. He said, just showed the path in front of him, the road leading towards Kedar. Then Gangadhar immediately looked at the road. "But this is a very ordinary road. All will walk on this one. There is nothing difficult about it. I thought to go to Kedar, we should jump from one hillock to another and reach Kedar." So then this Mayaram avadhut, who had gone several times on pilgrimage to all the places in Himalayas, he was surprised. He had never met a young man ready to jump from one hill to another and reach Kedar. See the determination of this young man. So immediately, in a surprised voice, he told his disciples and the devotees in front, "See, his guru has been merciful to them. Guru's grace he has got. That is why he has got so much of power in him, and the power of determination is in him to jump from hillock to hillock and reach Kedar." He has told it in Hindi, "Guru Meherban to Chela Pahalwar." The disciple becomes a big wrestler, that means powerful, with the grace of the Guru. Then afterwards Gangadhar visits Tibet. He visits the other Himalayan pilgrimages, Kedar, Badri, etc. Then goes to Tibet. Tibet was a very difficult place to go during that time, and British people were not allowing the Indians to cross over to Tibet, because Tibet was an unknown place for the British, and they thought that from Tibet, if somebody can come and attack, they may upset the whole plans of the British people to occupy India. So they were not in favor of any Indian crossing over to Tibet. But somehow he befriended some traders who were going to Tibet. Along with them he went and he entered Tibet. And they were going on their own way. They went almost near a big monastery of the Buddhists, and they left him there. So you go, this is the Tibet now. So nearby there is a monastery, you go and reach there. And they went away their way. It was already night. So when they went away, it became very dark. It was snowing. He did not know how to proceed further. Simply spent the night on the road itself in the freezing cold. Early morning, some Tibetan monks found him, thinking that he was dead, because nobody can be alive amid so much of snowfall and during the whole night, but found him breathing and being quite healthy and living. So they shouted, "Ge Lam," which means, "Oh, he is a Pavitra Brahmachari, he is a very holy and chasteful man, he is a very purity personified." Then they took him with great enthusiasm and then introduced him to the head of the monastery. There he stayed there, and within 15 days he picked up the Tibetan language, and he was there for some months, and he would talk to them and then he would give them very good advice. So afterwards he had so many other pilgrimages also. Everywhere he found that Sri Ramakrishna was behind him. In one of the pilgrimages, he went and got into a jungle in the night. He didn't know where to go, further or backward. So he just stood there in a jungle. Then people had told him earlier, "Don't go this way, it's a very dangerous path, because too many bloodthirsty animals are there." But then he would not listen. He went by that way, and the night came, he was caught in the jungle. Then he found so much of blood and bones fresh, lying all around. That means just then some beasts have eaten some other animals and left part of it and went away. But he was not afraid. He simply stood there praying to Sri Ramakrishna, and somehow or other Sri Ramakrishna came and led him out very safely to the other side of the jungle. He could see the helping hand of Sri Ramakrishna. Another time, he in a jungle, so he was caught again in a similar fashion. He didn't know what to do, to proceed further or go back. Both he could not do. Then he said, "Let me sit and meditate." When he started meditation, Sri Ramakrishna appeared to him, and then he said, "You see, this whole of Himalaya and its greenery are Shiva and Shakti. They are playing. It is a play of Shiva and Shakti." Then Sri Ramakrishna said, "Come, let us dance." So both of them started singing about Shiva and dancing. And Sri Ramakrishna started singing, "Bajbe go Maheshir Bukhe Neme Dada Aar Nachishne Khapa Magi." "Oh mad lady, dance no more on Shiva's chest. Please come down to us, into our heart." So this song they sang the whole night. Both of them were dancing. When it became a little light, the morning was dawning, then he found Sri Ramakrishna disappeared. He did not know that it was the divine appearance of Sri Ramakrishna. So such wonderful experiences had. The whole night had passed away in dancing and singing with Sri Ramakrishna. And another one night he went to see a Divine Mother's temple on a hillock. So after having the Divine Mother's darshan, then he came down from the hillock By that time it was all dark. So again, the whole place was a jungle. So there was no way. He did not know where, how to proceed. So what he did was, he just sat and meditated. So that made the things much worse. So when he got up from meditation, he further could not see the way that would lead him out of the jungle. Just he sat in a place and then started tumbling down. So he rolled down the whole hillock from there to 2 miles towards the plain, and he landed up in a field where it was a cultivated field. Some peasants were there. They were just looking, who is this in this darkness, this beast infested forest area, tumbling down the 2 miles of distance from top to bottom, getting all the bruises on the body. Who is this? They found this Gangadhar being alive with, of course, lot of wounds on his body. They said, no one has ever come by this route like this. How can anybody dare? That was Gangadhar, daredevil and hero of the heroes. So, like this, after all adventures, seeing so many pilgrimages, he comes back to Baranagar after 4 years, the Baranagar Mutt. So, in 1890, he takes sannyas, the ochre robe, and his name becomes Akhandananda. So, this Swami Akhandananji became very dear to Sri Ram, Swami Vivekananda, for one reason. Whatever Swami Vivekananda said, he would be the first man to accept it 100% and put it into practice. Especially, worship of God in man. Shivajnane Jiva Seva. Sri Ramakrishna had told that in every man, God alone lives. So worshipping man is equivalent to worship of God. Serving man is equivalent to worship of God. So this Swami Vivekananda made the motto of the Ramakrishna Mutt mission. To serve man, you serve God himself. If you want to serve God, start the service of God with serving man. So he was loving Swami Vivekananda so much, and he was loved also by Vivekananda. In 1892, he went with Swami Vivekananda to Himalayas. Then at Meerut, Swami Vivekananda and many other brother disciples, they were there. He joined them. So they spent some time. Afterwards, Swami Vivekananda announced his resolve to go alone. Till now, all of you, my brother disciples, you are meeting me here, there. So we are always exchanging our news, etc. I don't want to be bothered about any news. I want to be alone, left alone at the mercy of God. So the rest of my pilgrimages, I will do alone. Please, none of you should follow me. But then Gangadhar was so much attracted to Swami Vivekananda. He said, I will find you out wherever you go. Even if you go to Patala also, I will find you out. Then Swamiji disappeared. After some time, Gangadhar started following him. So he went to Baroda. He was not there, Swamiji had left. Then he went to Ahmedabad. There he had left. Went to Kutch Mandavi. There he had left. Then he went to Dwarka, Bhuj, Kutch Mandavi, Ashapuri. From Ashapuri he went to Narayan Sarovar on the seashore. And the way from Ashapuri to Narayan Sarovar was infested with the dacoits. So the people said, they will rob you not only of your money, they will rob you of your life, because the little money they take, they are afraid that you may go and report to police. They may kill you. So don't go this way. He said, no, I must go and find Swamiji. He may leave the next place also. So he left on the dangerous place. Only he said, ask them to teach him 2 sentences. So please don't kill me. and don't kill me, don't kill me. You tell me what I should say in those dacoits language. They taught him. Medegano, medegano, muke murio mu. Muke mario mu. Don't kill me. So don't kill me, don't kill me. So whenever he used to meet the robber, he used to tell this. So they would just rob away what he had, and then they would leave him off. Like this, facing all the troubles, he approaches, comes to Narayan Sarovar. There he finds Swamiji is left, Narayan Sarovar. Again he returns to the same robber or dacoit infested area, comes back and finds Swami on the other side in a place and talking to a number of devotees in a hall. So Akhandananda describes his meeting Swamiji, saying, I found the whole room was illuminated by the luminosity of Swami Vivekananda. I found not the form of Swami Vivekananda, but Vivekananda was the luminous light of ideas. It was ideas that were spreading all over like light. So I found no person, but he was an idea. From that time, he had the idea that Swamiji is no person. He is a new idea for this world to give which he has come. Then afterwards, again, Gangadhar comes back to Alam Bazar Mutt. Now the Paranagar Mutt had been left and the Mutt had been shifted to the next place. Then, staying at Alam Bazar Mutt, at that time, Swami Vivekananda has returned in 1897 after the first visit to the West. So he was staying, Swamiji was staying at Darjeeling. At that time, from the Alam Bazar Mutt, one day Gangadhar thought, let me go and see the place Plassey. Plassey, you all know, who know the Indian history. Plassey was the first place conquered by the British and who entered Bengal from Plassey only. Whole of Bengal came under the British after they entered Plassey and just conquered piece by piece by piece until the whole of Bengal was under them. So he said, our slavery has started from this place. Let me see this historical place. And we have to drive this slavery also out from this Plassey. So with such a determination, he left for Murshidabad. He said, in Murshidabad is Plassey there. And then he was returning after seeing Plassey. But on the way, he found everywhere famine. Famine, drought is there. No water, no food. And poor people are going without food, starving. People are about to die out of starvation. That was a terrible condition he saw. Then he said, let me somehow hurry out from this place. It is now dark. So he took shelter in a small village near Behrampur, in a village called Babda. There, when he got up in the morning and wanted to proceed towards the ashram at Alam Bazar, he was some force pushed him down. He wanted to get up and go, he was pushed down. And then he heard a voice saying, where will you go? You have a lot of work to do here. And then he found that he had to help the people who were in distress. He himself was a beggar. How could he help? He said, why? I want beg food for myself. Let me beg food for another person also, or another two persons also. And if some rich person is there, ask him to feed some people who are suffering. I will help these people. He made a determination like that. Then he stayed there and wrote to Alam Bazar that I am doing relief work here among these people. They were wonderstruck. How he, without pay in his pocket, will do the relief work? But he had started the relief work like this, begging food from here, asking some rich people to help the poor people, and he would go to the masjid after the Friday prayers and request the Muslim devotees, you see, people are suffering, both Hindus and Muslims, I want to help them, please give something, they gave him some money. So like when you are doing, the government itself came to know, this holy man is doing like this. Then government also came and started giving some relief to the people. So the relief first started when Swami Vivekananda learnt about this one. He was very, very, very happy. He said, "Cheerio, Gangadhar, you are the real hero. You are speaking the language that the whole world understands, the language of service, language of love. So you will certainly get help from others. I will myself send you money." So Swamiji himself sent money. So the relief went on. Then it ended up with Gangadhar, with Swami Akhandananji, opening an orphanage in that place called Mahula village. Now it is one of our famous centers in Sargachi. Sargachi is the place, and Mahula village was the place where he started the relief work. So in the during the relief, he found orphans. Father and mother have died. So he collected about 40 orphans. So the orphanage started, and also he started a school to teach them some useful crafts along with the three R's. That is how the first relief work of our Ramakrishna Mutton Mission was started on May 15th of 1897. The very first relief work, and it's continued over these years, increasing in number, increasing in its volume. So in his orphanage, he introduced worshipping the orphans as Narayanas themselves. For example, during giving them bath, young boys were there. They had to be bathed. So when you pour water on them, just as we utter the Vedic mantra during bathing the either Shivalinga or Salagram, we utter the Vedic mantra. We used to utter the Vedic mantra. Sahasra Shirsha Purusha, Sahasra Chat Sahasra Pat. We used to utter the mantra and bathe the children. That is how an ideal orphanage used to learn. So other people whom he knew in Varanasi, one great pandit of Varanasi, Pramadadas Mitra, he remarked, "Oh, Akhandananda, what are you doing? You have started an orphanage that is getting into Maya's clutches. Give it up, come over to Varanasi and do some spiritual practices here." But then Akhandananda wrote him in a very strong language. He said, "I also once thought like that, but now I see it is Narayana alone who is there in all these children. So I am not in the clutches of Maya, I am of Narayana's. So I am serving them. So now I believe that God is living in every being." So like that, he carried on the work of serving God in man. So on the July 4th, Swami Vivekananda passes away, and Swami Akhandananda was very much pained. He was about to commit suicide, standing on the line of a tram line. But Swami Vivekananda had passed away. On the seventh or eighth day, this determination of Swami Akhandananda to give up his life. So at that juncture, Swamiji appeared in the divine body and took him out from the tram line and saved him. So this incident, Akhandananda himself related to Miss MacLeod later on. "I saw Swamiji just as I see you now with these eyes." So Swami Vivekananda appeared to him in his divine body. So like this, he had so many experiences of the divine Swami Vivekananda, divine Sri Ramakrishna. And in the meanwhile, his work was progressing. One Muslim zamindar gave him 16 acres of land, almost a free cost, a throwaway price. So he took it against all opposition from the headquarters. They said, "You have to pay annual taxes for the land. Unless you do something and then earn something out of it, how will you pay the taxes?" But the headquarters said, "No, he is giving 16 acres, I require. I want to teach many things of agriculture and all that." But headquarters would not agree for him. suddenly he got a divine dream in which Swami Vivekananda appeared and told him, Gangadhar, I want all the 16 acres of land. So Gangadhar got up the next morning, wrote to headquarters, last night I saw a divine dream. Swamiji wants all the 16 acres. Is it so? All right, you take. And that 16 acres, some more acres added now. We got a great work going on of educating the common people in several skills. We got a higher secondary school there, and so many other relief and rehabilitation work there going on. So in 1934, he became the president of the order, Ramakrishna Order, and 1936, Holy Mother's birthday, he would not eat anything the whole day. Whenever the birthday of Sri Ramakrishna, Holy Mother Swamiji would come, he would keep himself empty stomach, moving around and enjoying all other people eating and dancing and having fun. So on that day also, almost 10 o'clock till 10 o'clock in the night, he was hungry. He had not taken any food, but he did not feel at all. And at 10 o'clock also, he was singing and playing tabla also up to 1:30 in the night. He used to tell others, look, the power of Sri Ramakrishna with this old man, old body of mine, above almost nearing 70 years, how much power he has kept here at 1:30 with empty stomach, how much power I manifest. So he was proud about Sri Ramakrishna being himself, conducting himself through every one of his work. So the last year of his life, 1937, so it was Swami Vivekananda's last birthday he saw on this earth. So he did not take food from morning and till night 10 o'clock. When the night 10 o'clock, after the bhog, that is the offering was done at the temple, and then bhog was brought for him to eat, he said, what bhog are you going to give me? I was with Swami Vivekananda now in meditation. How many things he fed me now? I ate so many wonderful things. That means he has gone to see Swami Vivekananda wherever he is. That was Swami Akhandananda. So in the last days also, he had a premonition of his death. He said, I am seeing everyone's inside as somebody sees the things inside a glass and mirror. So he said, this happens only during the last days of a man's life, of a realized man's life. And he says, I can see everything inside everyone. And then last few days, he used to meet people and would tell again and again, let me bless all those people who have helped me, who have hindered my work. I bless everyone. Why should I be deceived? Because everyone is Lord. God alone has become the good people and bad people also. Why should I be deceived like this? I bless everyone. He gave blessings to everyone. And then he said, give me all your sins, whoever has got any sins, and take in return my merits. Give me all your papa, take away all my punya. I am not afraid of any papa. Nothing can touch me because I am a child of Sri Ramakrishna. So divine person, what can any sin touch me? No sin can touch, neither can merit also touch. It was beyond sin and merit. So that was the glorious life of Swami Akhandanandji. Then he said, as a premonition of his death, I will be till the last day of my life here at Sargachi. And then, but I will not die here. I will die in Belur Math. And I will be taken to Belur Math by the monastic members of the Math. How all could come true? Nobody could imagine. He was all alone there. There was no monastic member from headquarters. Nobody had informed headquarters also. But it all happened. So he went into coma diabetes. So and then he was in coma in the morning on 6th. Then 6th morning of February 1937. And in his coma state, he was taken in the train, then reached Calcutta in the night. Then he was taken to Udbodhan, mother's place, in the coma state. Then he was taken to the Dakshineshwar, mother's, divine mother Kali's place. Then from there he was brought to Belur Mutt and made to stay in the room next to Swami Vivekananda's room in Belur Mutt. Next day morning, 7th February 1937, at 3 p.m., his Mahasamadhi came. He gave up his mortal coil and went away to the abode from where he came. He was 72 years, 5 months. So he was an embodiment of Sri Ramakrishna's Vijnani model. So Sri Ramakrishna used to say, the Jnani sees the world as a dream. Vijnani sees the whole world as the manifestation of God Himself. God Himself is this world also. So everything in this world is divine. It was a great Vijnani he was. He spent his life and he served every human being thinking he was worshipping God. To serve man to him was worshipping God. This is the hallmark of every Ramakrishna Mutt Mission member. We all believe in the service of man as a worship of God. That was Swamiji's message. It was Sri Ramakrishna's message. So on this sacred day of Swami Akhandananda's birthday, let us remember that the whole universe is the manifested Brahman. The Brahman in front of our eyes. Brahman is behind our eyes and our heart. Brahman is in front of us also in the form of human beings, being the best representative of God. So may Sri Ramakrishna, Holy Mother, Swami Vivekananda and Swami Akhandananji bless us all on this day for our spiritual progress and useful and worshipful life. Jai Ramakrishna, Jai Holy Mother, Jai Swami Vivekananda, Jai Swami Akhandananda.